It was the year of our Lord, 1492. Rodrigo Borgia, a Spanish bull and vice chancellor of the Vatican, would soon become the most powerful man in the kingdom of God, and with him the children of his intemperance, Juan Borgia, Cesare Borgia, and Lucrezia Borgia. Unbeknownst to me at the time, I myself would soon play an important role in the rise of this family. But for now, all my worries belong to my ill friend, Lorenzo de' Medici, thus leading me, on one rainy morning, to his home in Florence, not knowing that the shadows of Rome, seemingly so distant, would soon be moving with me. The letter was written by Agostina's lover. Among his displays of affection, he directly asked her for secret information concerning the peace negotiations between Milan and Naples. Based on the condition of the letter, I assumed that after Agostina had read this, she had torn the paper in disappointment. But in order to confirm this suspicion, I needed more evidence.
Thank you.
Piero's horror about his father's death seemed real. However, I felt that he knew more about the situation than he was willing to show. Despite his threats, I chose to return to the villa that night and investigate further. Once more, everything revolved around the conflict between the two states of Naples and Milan. The Holy Father was gravely ill and would soon succumb to his fever. Piero de' Medici was asked to talk his father into influencing the election of the new pope. Under no circumstances should Rodrigo Borgia be allowed to win the election. He, like Lorenzo before, would continue the peace efforts. The case grew more and more complicated. I decided to return to my abbey in Camaldoli and ask my mentor, Ardicino della Porta, for advice. The coat of arms belonged to the Colonna family, a powerful Roman clan that had become a fierce enemy of Rodrigo Borgia. Borgia himself was a very promising candidate for the throne of St. Peter, and amongst the few who were striving for peace between Naples and Milan. If Lorenzo had to die for the same ambition, then maybe Rodrigo Borgia would be next. Ardicino looked at me furiously. The church had become all about politics. All about wealth and power, losing its humble faith in God. Thank the Lord for the young ones of Florence who are returning to their Christian beliefs and willing to fight for them. Ardicino described the situation between Milan and Naples. The regents of both states raised claim to Milan. Whichever side was able to successfully manipulate the election of the Pope and put its own candidate on the throne of St. Peter would also be able to win Milan. And thus, the young apprentice and I left for Rome. Silvio's curiosity about the world and his faith in the Lord were honorable, as were his aspirations to bring justice to this world. Ardicino had given us a letter for Rodrigo Borgia, asking him to help us find Lorenzo's murderer. Thus, just a few days after our first meeting in Camaldoli, I was once again about to meet the man whose future would soon lie in my hands.
Thank you.
I confronted Marcantonio with the evidence. He denied that the letter was his. Until Cesare approached his table, he grabbed Marcantonio and threatened him, forcing him to speak the truth. Yes, he had urged Agostina to find out details about the peace negotiations, but there had never been a reason to resort to murder. Lacking any further evidence, I believed him. Juan arrogantly walked up to Giuliano della Rovere. I could see the excitement in his eyes as he approached not only della Rovere, but also his daughter, Felice. All three entered the house while Silvio and I stayed behind. I told Silvio and Juan about my findings. An envoy of the French king called Philippe Beroul tried to bribe the cardinals into making Giuliano della Rovere the next pontifex. Apart from that, there seemed to be no connection to the murder of Lorenzo. We bid Juan farewell and returned to St. Peter's. Thank you. Giulia Farnese was a stunningly beautiful woman. She consented to help me with my investigation of Virginio Orsini and pointed out his headquarters on my map. She also offered to distract Virginio. We had located the French envoy, Philippe Berul, unaware of what would happen next and unwilling to put Silvio further into harm's way, I sent him away. From now on, his destiny was to be at the side of Ardicino della Porta. Together, they would join the conclave and pave the way for a new pope, a just and pious pope. Before he left, he handed me the wooden cross he always wore. He told me that he had seen a lot of terror in his youth in Florence. But through me, he had learned that there were more people like him who were willing to fight the corruption and the darkness in this world. Then he took his bag and left for Camaldoli. I should have never let him go. tried to explain myself, told them about the cross, that it had been given to me by a boy named Silvio, but all to no avail. The guards grabbed me and dragged me into the darkest cell of Castel Sant'Angelo. Days passed. The Pope died. The citizens of Rome took to the streets, rioting, killing, looting. Rodrigo Borgia, Ardicino della Porta, and the other cardinals joined the conclave to elect the new leader of the Holy Church. Who cares about an unimportant little monk in times like these? Thus, in my tiny prison cell, I had all the time in the world to think about what had happened to me. And so it was here, in this lonely place, that I finally completed the puzzle and solved the case. Silvio was carrying Lorenzo's cross. Could this alone make him the murderer? When I talked to Lorenzo, he mentioned a young servant who usually avoided him. Could that have been Silvio? As a servant, it would have been easy for him to poison Lorenzo's wine, then steal the wooden cross and flee to Camaldoli. But why would he do such a thing? Was he just a mere thief? Wanting to steal from the wealthiest man in Florence? Or was there more to it? The rosary I found with the dead envoy might have belonged to Silvio. Even the poison on the dagger was the same as the one used on Lorenzo. Didn't Silvio insist on learning about the Frenchman's hiding place? After we parted, he could have gone to the tavern and killed the envoy, possibly, but it still did not make any sense. Why would he commit such a cold-blooded murder? He did not even know the man. And then I realized the devout youth of Florence were under the influence of the mad preacher Savonarola. The monk agitated the young men with his furious sermons against the corruption of the church, and knowing Silvio, I'd say he was accessible to the idea of punishing impiousness with all means necessary. As Lorenzo's servant, it would have been easy to commit the murder, especially after having learned about de' Medici's attempt to bribe a cardinal. The French envoy also wanted to influence the papal election and was killed as well. Silvio considered himself a servant of a better world. His conviction was so powerful that he was willing to kill for it. I lost myself in the darkness. These tunnels were an escape route for the Pope, leading from the Sistine Chapel to Castel Sant'Angelo, the Holy Father's fortress. They led me deeper and deeper beneath the city, until I stumbled upon a wall. I had reached the halls under the conclave. Oh Lord, may I not be too late. Thank you. morning broke, the cardinals were asleep, and all my fears confirmed. Silvio looked at me. I had expected to see the face of a devil, his true face, which he used to hide under a mask of innocence. But instead, I stared into the eyes of a frightened child. The jar burst. Footsteps approached, and a cruel determination crawled into Silvio's eyes. A moment later, Rodrigo and Ardicino della Porta appeared in the chapel. It was the same poison as in Lorenzo's wine. Silvio's guilt was proven. While the other cardinals were sleeping, dreaming of power and intrigue, I and Rodrigo's servant smuggled the boy out of the chapel, into the tunnels, and eventually back to the dungeons of Castel Sant'Angelo. Here, he would stay hidden from the eyes of a world that may never realize how close it had come to a horrible fate. A few days later, Rodrigo Borgia was elected the new pope. Ardicino told me that the rumors concerning the French envoy had made Della Rovere lose all chances of winning the election, instead paving the way for Rodrigo Borgia, now Pope Alexander VI.